we glorify God again this evening because he is worthy of our glory and worship. He is our creator and our redeemer. And for his name's sake, by the way, we congregate every evening to listen to his word, only to glorify him, not to glorify us or anybody, but to lift up high his name and give glory and honor all to him. Today, I want to make a final submission about the bread. And we had seen the significance of the bread. And just time, let me do a quick review because we are doing a final submission on the bread. Let me do a quick review of what we have seen, that this is the sanctuary model. And here we have the shadow or the symbol of the plan of redemption, that is the shadow of the gospel, the shadow of the cross. So in this apartment, for those who are joining afresh, we have the outer court. Here we have the altar of burnt offering. We have the laver. And this entire area, by the way, we have not exhausted the courtyard yet, okay? Because we can never exhaust the gospel. This symbolizes the entire ministry of Jesus Christ. In fact, if somebody put it like this, that if the works and the history of Jesus Christ in his humanity alone was to be put down in writing, the waters in the ocean could not be ink enough to write about the glory and the beauty and the ministry of Christ. So by that, I want to imply that we can never exhaust in details everything that Christ performed, and he is, by the way, still performing on behalf of the human race, on behalf of you and me. And then here, that Jesus Christ entered the holy place in the year 1844. He started a ministry in the holy place of the heavenly sanctuary. In fact, Jesus is now in the heavenly sanctuary, but here on earth, the representative of the Godhead that is here with us is the Holy Spirit. And that is why the holy place is an apartment of the Holy Ghost. Okay? The holy place represents the duty of the Holy Spirit in our lives. As Christ ministers in the holy place in the heavenly sanctuary, the Holy Spirit ministers in the sanctuary or the temple of God, that is our hearts. And let me just remind us what the truth is. People ask, is where Jesus is ministering in. Well, we have had questions about this. And one day I had one professor arguing, and he was undermining the reality, and he called it the heavenly geography, that the heaven is partitioned in this place, and this place is most holier. So in his understanding as a Bible scholar, he disputed the reality of the existence, a literal existence of the sanctuary in heaven. But the truth is, when we read from the word of God, we get the answers to every question that we will ever have. By the way, I love to repeat this, and this is what you must also know that the Bible has all the answers to every question that you may ever have. I'm reading from Hebrews chapter 8, beginning from verse 1. It says, Now the point in what we are saying is this. Mm-hmm. We have such a high priest, one who is seated at the right hand of the throne of majesty in heaven, a minister in the holy place, in the true tent that the Lord set up, not man. Allow me to read it in King James, because we get more accurate wording in King James for the sake of what we are studying today. I'm reading the book of Hebrews, chapter 8 and verse 1, just in case somebody was wondering or doubting if there's a sanctuary in heaven. Says, now of the things which we have spoken, which are the things that he has spoken, and what are these things that we are speaking? Of the things that we have been studying about the sanctuary, about the outer court, about the courtyard, about the justification. Now, of these things which we have spoken, this is the sum. Add everything up, and this is the sign, the sum, okay? We have such an high priest who is set on the right hand of the throne of majesty in heaven. We have such an high priest. We are going to talk about the priesthood of Christ, why the Bible is using, we have such an high priest, a priest of this kind. We have such an high priest, and Jesus is the one who is called a priest of this kind, one of his kind. Okay, and what is the more the importance of the priesthood of his kind? He says, he is a minister of the sanctuary and the true tabernacle which the Lord pitched, and not man. So we have a minister of the true sanctuary and the true tabernacle, which the Lord himself pitched. So do we have a sanctuary in heaven? The truth is, yes. We have the sanctuary in heaven, where Christ has entered the holy place of the sanctuary. You see, if your mind is focused only on the geographical location of the holy place, you still miss the point. If your focus is also only on the geographical position of the courtyard, you miss the point. The truth is, we must see the fulfillment of all the facets of the holy place in the revelation of Christ, the person and ministry of Christ. Okay, so the courtyard and all its services, the slaughtering of the lamb and the bulls and the goats and the confession of sin and the baptism and the washing of regeneration. If our mind is only focused on the physical activities, yes, it is true the physical activities were ordained by God, but if that does not lead us to the true tabernacle, which is the true revelation of Jesus Christ, we still miss the point. That is why the Israelites, in the observance of those rituals and practices, yet they miss the person who was there then with them. Real time, right there at that particular time, they missed Christ because their mind was focused on the rituals. Listen, even today, most of our attention is focused, I dare say, on the observance of the Saturday and not the true meaning of rest that we need to experience with God. We are so absorbed in the rituals of the Lord's Supper that we miss the true meaning of the revelation of the Lord's Supper, as it is in Christ who says, I am the living bread, I am the bread of life, I am that bread which came from above. So why the Lord's Supper? We saw yesterday that before they could partake of the Lord's Supper, Jesus took it to wash the feet of his will do the life of individual people, especially those who are living in the end time. There are three activities in the Lord's Supper that we need to look into and their significance in Christ. We saw already the foot washing, which we practice, we all know. And we saw yesterday there's a symbol of the cleansing of the sin of the entire world, because the dirty feet symbolizes the character that we have built along as we walk this journey. And you know what is in your character. You know what anger has produced in your life. You know what envy has produced in your life. You know what lust has produced in your life. So that as we journey, as we walk the journey of life, our feet are sweeping along the way, all the dirt as we move along. So God chooses to wash away the dirt from our lives. And that is through the blood and the water, which proceeded from the heart of Jesus Christ when he was pierced by that spear. I said, there are three components of the Lord's Supper. Number one is the feet washing. Number two is the bread itself, partaking of the bread. And number three is partaking of the wine or the grape juice, or what we would call the blood of Christ. He says, this is my blood, when he is giving the wine. So why does the Church of God observe these three significant aspects of the Lord's Supper? We have seen, we have seen the foot washing. Let me read for you what is in. The Lord's Supper is a participation in the emblem of the body and the blood of Jesus as an expression of faith in him. Okay. Remember, Jesus said, we saw when we read in John chapter 13, he is instructing them to keep this as a memorial, as a remembrance of him who is the true meaning of the bread. So here we read that the Lord's Supper is a participation of the blood of Jesus as an expression of faith in him, our Lord and Savior. So that's a demonstration that we believe in Christ. We trust the process that Christ is engaging himself in. Now, the moment it is sufficiently convinced in our minds that this is true way of salvation, the Bible says, your way, O God, is in the sanctuary. When our minds are sufficiently convinced that what Christ did is for us, then our hearts respond with a heartfelt thank you, and we demonstrate as a sign of thank you to what Christ has done in the washing of our feet and in the symbolizing the blood of Jesus Christ. Let's say, in this experience of communion in Christ is present to in this experience of communion, Christ is present to meet and strengthen in. When we partake of the bread, we believe as the servants of God that Sabbath is holy because the presence of God makes it holy. Here we see that in the experience of communion with Christ in partaking of the supper, Christ himself, okay, is present to meet and strengthen his people. I want to clear this. I want to put this clearly. You know, there are some religious institutions that believe that when you take these, when you take of the bread and you partake of the wine, that this bread becomes the real body of Christ. Well, that may not be true, because this is not the physical real body of Christ. This is an emblem or a symbol of the body of Christ. And we saw when we were talking about the bread that this symbolizes the belief we have in the true life that Jesus Christ puts in us. So the bread itself, as some churches teach, is not, does not transform itself into the real body of Christ. Okay, when you partake of that bread, you are not chewing the literal flesh of Christ. We are taking symbolically of that life by chewing the flesh of Christ. No, you partake of the life of Christ by partaking of his word by faith. And so the Holy Spirit transforms the character and the very life as symbol. It does not of Christ as some want us to believe. As we partake, we joyfully proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Preparations for the supper includes self-examination, repentance, and confession. I remember when I was still young, a Tuesday before the Sabbath, when people partake of the Lord's Supper, people would come to church and would confess their sins one to another. Well, that, I think that had been abolished. The truth is, we may not necessarily confess our sins one to another, though it's okay if you choose to, it's okay, so that you may pray for one another. But him, Jesus Christ, have only one mediator between God and man. We have only one name through which men and women shall be saved, the name of Jesus Christ. We have only one mediator between man and God, and this mediator is the man, Jesus Christ. So here, as a preparation to the Lord's Supper, it says, preparation for the supper includes self-examination, repentance, and confession. Must have realized that all these are functions of the Holy Spirit in us. Bible talks of Christ that him has God delivered for to give repentance to Israel. So repentance is a gift from God. So preparatory or in preparation for the Lord's Supper, we are to engage in a process of self-examination or repentance. Self-examination is otherwise a process of conviction. Okay, it says concerning the Holy Spirit that he will convict the world of sin. He will convict the world of sin. Okay, who is this that convicts the world of sin? That is the work of the Holy Spirit. You must realize and you must be conscious of the work of the Holy Spirit in preparing yourself for a communion with Jesus Christ that is symbolized or typified in partaking of the Lord's Supper. It says, self-examination, and of course, how do we examine ourselves? How do you examine yourself? You don't have the standards of measure, to measure yourself or to examine yourself. You must be examined by the standards of God. And how is that possible? Only the Holy Spirit can be allowed to do a search. He says, search me, O Lord, search my heart, O Lord. It is only the Holy Spirit that can search our hearts and look deep into our hearts for that which is hid in us as sin. And when the Holy Spirit displays it before us, then we can confess. But again, confession also is a gift of the Spirit. We saw when we were talking about baptism, okay, that Jesus took the step of confession, repentance, and conversion. We saw that when we read from the pen of inspiration. So the truth is, it is a process for those of us who are partaking of the Lord's Supper. It is an opportunity for us to be examined by the Holy Spirit. But to condemn is to reverse our true nature. Continue with the process of conviction and confession. I love how the three persons of the Godhead are involved in the process of our redemption. So repentance and confession. The master ordained the service of foot washing to signify renewed cleansing, to express a willingness to serve one another in Christ-like humility, and to unite our hearts in love. The communion service open to all believing Christians. Mm-hmm. The community service is open to all. This is what the Church of God said. It is open to all believing Christians. Why is it open to all believing Christians? It's a process through which God is seeking to, number one, bring to us a self-examination. Of course, we have said that this is by the Holy Spirit. And again, it brings to us the reality of repentance and confession. Every believing Christian, I wish it would be possible that when we are approaching the Lord's Supper in that week, prior to that week, we may do an invitation for every believing Christian to come and partake in the process. Listen, the Lord's Supper is not your process. The Lord's Supper is Lord's Supper. God has invited us to his supper where we have an experience and a fellowship with him. Well, some of the times, because of failure to understand the true meaning of the Lord's Supper, we have some restrictions that edges out some people from partaking. Last quarter, when I was talking to a friend of mine who felt that, that this friend of mine had had challenges, a lot of challenges and temptation, and he was at the very depth. He was low in his life experience, and he thought to a degree that the Lord has left him. And while we were approaching the Lord's Supper, we were almost partaking of the Lord's Supper, he told me that, my friend, I am not ready for the Lord's Supper. I think I'm too sinful. I think I'm not worthy to partake of the Lord's Supper. Listen, who qualifies for the communion with Christ? Let me give you some of the qualifications for those who qualify to commune with Jesus Christ. I'm reading from the book of Romans, chapter 5, verse 6. I'm reading Romans. We were yet without strength. In due time, Christ died for the ungodly. Let me go to verse 8. But God commended his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. 9. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. So who qualifies to commune with Jesus Christ? The only one who qualifies to commune with Christ is that one whom he died for. And whom did he die for? The Bible says, while we were yet in sin, verse 6, for when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the who? The ungodly. So he's calling all the ungodly men and women to commune with him in this process, because God, through the Lord's Supper, is working a work of refreshment, what we like to call sanctification. Listen, the issue here is the meaning of the bread. Every sinner with a contrite heart can come just as he is. And by the way, we should open the door to every sinner who has felt repentance in his heart and self-examination and confession of sin. We must open the door for every sinner to come freely and partake of the Lord's Supper, because it's God's process of sanctifying us through the work of the Holy Spirit and through partaking of the bread that symbolizes the body of Jesus Christ. So the bread is a symbol of the body of Christ. We have seen that it is open for everyone, every sinner. The communion service is open to all believing Christians, that we may come and partake of the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper celebrated today is a communion service, is an opportunity for believers to honor the gift of God in the sacrifice of Christ. In doing this, the Apostle Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 26, see what Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 26. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 26. For as often as you eat this bread, you eat the Lord's death till he comes. So it is an emblem, a memorial of the meaning of the death of Christ. In other words, what he achieved by his death. And it was not, it's not a one-day event. He says we have to remember this continually. He says, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do shew the Lord's death till he comes. So there are two facts there that are demonstrated there in verse 26 of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, that you do it oftentimes, okay? Meaning, like it has been said in the Church of God, we do it once every quarter. But he has said, we observe this till he comes, okay? So we must not only do it oftentimes, okay? We do it oftentimes, but for how long? Until when he comes. Forever, okay? Some people, a few years, and then after some point, you stop partaking of the Lord's Supper. No, you have to do it oftentimes, like the frequency that the Church of God has determined is once every quarter, but you must not do it for 10 years, then you stop, as some people have done. You do it oftentimes, but then until his second coming. So maybe I want to encourage somebody who thinks that he is not reasonable enough, that he is not in your life. You are experiencing some lowest moment of your life. And when next week, for instance, a Lord's Supper is called upon, you shy away from partaking of the Lord's Supper. No, no, no. This is a right opportune time for you to return to God. And may I make this appeal in the middle this presentation. If for some with Christ in Lord's in communing in the Lord's Supper, why don't you consider taking part in the Holy Communion in the next service. Okay, listen, you will not prepare yourself enough to be fit for God. Come the way you are, because God is calling you to commune with you. He had died for you already while you are still sinning, while you are still ungodly. So what is this that is so ungodly in you that can separate between you and God? In fact, the very fact that you are a sinner is the very fact that God loves you the way you are and calling you, listen, and transform. So don't wait at home. Come and commune with God in partaking of the Lord's Supper, and that process, the meaning of that process has in it the power to effect a transformation in our lives. The Lord's Supper follows the words of Jesus Christ during the Last Supper. He ate before his crucifixion. As detailed in the New Testament Gospel, he and his disciples came together to celebrate the Passover meal in remembrance of Israel's deliverance from slavery in Egypt. So why were they celebrating the Passover that nowadays we have symbolized by the Holy Communion? They celebrated the victory in remembrance of Israel. And we know that we have been delivered from Egypt was a symbolic of deliverance from sin, as we saw earlier, that it took many sons, firstborn sons, to deliver them from Egypt. But it took the death of another firstborn, only begotten son to deliver us from the Egypt of sin, and to take Egypt out from us. So the Lord's Supper is also a symbol of celebration, of victory over sin. You're waiting for a time when you can estimate your human performance and think that now you have qualified. Listen, the victory over sin is not your victory per se. The victory over sin is Christ's victory over sin. And when shall we celebrate that victory? Every day of your life is a celebration day for the victory that Christ has won on behalf of the humans. The more you become a victor over sin. Are you beginning to see that the Lord's Supper also has a role in playing out the victory of Christ in our lives? You see, when you celebrate many times, for those who love soccer or football, when you get acquainted with victory, it becomes authentic. Victory becomes authentic. When we begin to enjoy celebration of Christ's victory, okay, we become acquainted with his victory, and overcoming sin become easy because we have become acquainted with him whose victory is ours. This time, however, as they partook of the unleavened bread and the fruit of vine, Jesus gave new meaning to these items. And even before they ate together, Jesus demonstrated his love for his disciples and humanity by performing a servant's job, as we have seen. He washed his disciples' feet. By doing this, he showed an example of kindness and unconditional love. So we see that this bread that was taken during the Passover was unleavened. The bread represents Christ's body broken for us, as we see in the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 26, verse 26. I'm reading Matthew 26, verse 26. It says, And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body. Take and eat, this is my body." You see, you cannot eat if you do not take. I hope that is clear. You cannot eat unless you take. Jesus is offering his life. But you see, you cannot eat and experience the life of Jesus Christ if you reject and you fail to take or to receive. Receive and eat. If you don't open your heart to receive the gift of Christ's righteousness, it is made available. It is enough for everyone, but those who will refuse to take and eat, they will miss the experience of victory of bread. He says again in John 6:48, "I am the bread of life." Mm-hmm. And he goes ahead to explain in John 6:51, "I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever." Why will he live forever? Because the life that is in the bread, the life that is of Christ, is an everlasting life. We said yesterday that the eternal life or the everlasting life is not so much on the length or the period of time, but on the quality of the life that Christ gives to us. I may want to repeat this. Anybody who accepts Jesus Christ is living an eternal life. Right now, right here, today. In giving his body for the world, God made a way for us to be saved from the eternal consequences of sin. By believing in and accepting Jesus' death and resurrection, Jesus, the true bread of heaven, satisfies the deepest longings of our hearts. I want to read that again. Jesus Christ, the true bread of heaven, satisfies the deepest longings of our hearts. God, in his divine grace, has put a hunger for the world. As a consequence of sin, God has allowed a hunger in the heart of man. You see, sometimes we struggle to satisfy ourselves by things that perish, okay? By accumulating, amassing wealth to ourselves, by amassing joy and celebration to ourselves, by the pleasures and lusts of this world. Listen, the only food and bread that satisfies not the stomach, but the longing of the heart, the desires of the heart. The only bread that can fully satisfy the desires of the heart and the soul of man is Jesus Christ, our living Savior. He has said he is the living bread. Is there longing in your heart? What is it that you are longing for in your heart? What is this desire that you're praying for, that you're fasting for, that you're crying for? What are you, is it a job? What is it that you're crying to God for? Is it an employment? Is it help? Listen, in this one man Christ, in the gift of Christ, God has poured down to the entire human race all the gifts of heaven. And what is the gift of heaven? In Christ, we have and receive the goodness, the godliness of God, and everything else that is God, we receive in the person of Jesus Christ. This is a wonderful gift that we must not let go. It says, "Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and are dead." Jesus told the religious leaders, when we read that in John chapter 6, verse 49, the true bread of heaven is not a sandwich, it's not manna. This true bread symbolizes a spiritual nourishment to completely satisfy the soul's hunger. Accepting Jesus Christ, the bread of life, will fill our hearts with meaning and love. Accepting Jesus will give us the assurance of eternal life in heaven with him. Why does accepting Jesus Christ give us assurance of the eternal life with him? Because when you accept Jesus Christ, that eternal life, as we have said, becomes yours already. What a beautiful thing is it for us to accept Jesus Christ? Because by accepting him, we accept life eternal. Why was the bread unleavened? Or why do we prepare the Lord's Supper as we do unleavened? During the Passover, God instructed the Israelites to be ready to leave as soon as Pharaoh gave his consent of the dough which they had brought out of Egypt, for it was not leavened, because they were driven out of Egypt and could not wait, nor had they prepared provisions for themselves. Through the years, as the Israelites celebrated the Passover, they used the unleavened bread as a reminder of their hasty exodus from Egypt. Okay, the Apostle Paul added additional meaning to eating unleavened bread at times of remembrance when he wrote to the Corinthians church. And that is 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 6 to verse 8. It says, "Do you not know lamb? Therefore, purge out the old leaven, that you may be a new lamb, since you truly are unleavened. For indeed Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth." That is from New King James, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 6 to verse 8. Now the bread is unleavened, or the Lord's Supper is unleavened, because it symbolizes the unadulterated pure character of Christ. It's unleavened because it symbolizes the pure and adulterated life of Jesus Christ. Let's say something about the wine of the Jews. It says, the fruit of the fruit of the vine symbolizes Jesus' blood that was shed for us. In Matthew chapter 26 and verse 28, Matthew 26 verse 28, this is what Jesus says. I'm reading Matthew chapter 26 and verse 28. He says, let me start with verse 27. It says, "And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of it." Okay. So Jesus gives and instructs us to drink all of his there has a dual meaning. It must drink of it and its fullness. Okay, so we must drink, all of us. Christ is calling all of us believers, all of us, to drink the blood of Jesus Christ. But again, and we must drink it all. In other words, drink it in its fullness. Because Christ is giving himself in his fullness to us. As a people of God, we must endeavor, in fact, encourage all of us to partake of this blood that is the life of Jesus Christ and take it fully in its fullness. Because in Christ is the fullness of Godhead bodily. When we partake of the fullness of the blood of Jesus Christ, we are filled with the fullness of Christ until we grow to the fullest stage of Jesus Christ. Verse 28, for this is my blood of the New Testament, or the New Covenant. By grace, we want to talk about the New Covenant and the Everlasting Covenant. For this is my blood of the new, of the Everlasting Covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sin. So, the blood of Jesus Christ, or the wine that we partake, is to remind us of the everlasting covenant that God had made, that Christ had gone into to redeem mankind. So every time you partake of that, let me share this. Every time you hold this cup in your hand and you hold this bread in your hand, the holding of the cup must bring to our minds the everlasting covenant. You know that God has made a covenant. In other words, God has sealed his covenant with an oath. God has taken an oath. I remember when politicians are sworn in, when penned the constitution, that they may not go against the constitutions of the land. God had taken an oath in this covenant to defend you and to protect you and to redeem you. Can you imagine God taking an oath by his own name? Oh, yes, he did. He took an oath. God has sworn that he will redeem you. And that is what the blood reminds us, because Jesus says, this is my blood of the new covenant, or the new blood, a little wine to remind you of God's covenant. So remember this always, the covenant of God that God has sworn by his own name. You see, God could only swear by his own name because there's nothing above him that he could swear by. A lot of times we swear by the constitution because the constitution is higher in authority. But for those who worked in the forces, they know that the order, so when they are instructed, when they're given orders by their seniors, okay, they follow not because their sin has spoken, but because they have an order that is higher than the one who's giving. Listen, Jesus or God had no one higher by which he could swear. He swore by his own name that he will protect, redeem, and save you. And that is the meaning of the blood and the wine, that it reminds us of what God has done. If God has sworn by his name, what are the chances that he may fail and abandon the process of redemption? Any sinner who holds the glass of wine and partake of the wine must be reminded. There's no way that God will abandon midway the plan of redemption. Jesus did not abandon the plan of passed away from me. Remember the cup of Jesus Christ. He said, not as I will, but as you will, your will be done. Jesus drank the cup to the dregs. Listen, Every time you hold the cup or the glass of wine or the juice, wine here, by the way, is not alcohol. Wine there is the fresh fruit juice. Anytime you take of that wine, be reminded of the everlasting covenant, the covenant God has made, that he will indeed save you. Remember Christ when he drank of that cup, when he said, "Not my will, but your will be done." It should remind us of the last experience of Jesus Christ at Gethsemane. He says, "I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Above all, considering the ways fermented wine is often condemned in Scripture, it should not be.
Speaker seems to be having
it
some.
It should be pure juice, as we love to see. Listen, we say that we cannot exhaust everything about the Lord's Supper. But this is the truth. When we partake of the Lord's Supper, we be reminded he has chosen the symbols of the bread. May we open our hearts to receive the blood and the flesh, which symbolizes the life of Christ in us, as he seeks to perfect our character, that we may match the requirements of heaven. Jesus is a loving God, and he has chosen to work in your life. Today, my call for us is, may we behold Christ in the Lord's Supper. May we behold Christ. May we behold Christ in the Lord's Supper. May we partake of the real life of Christ, that is the reagent that sanctifies us from all impurities and sin, making us ready for the kingdom that is to come. But listen, the kingdom that is to come is not a future thing. The kingdom of God for us is now. The bread reminds us that we commune with God now and will continue forever in Jesus' name. Let us bow our heads for a word of prayer. Mighty Father in heaven, you are the eternal bread. You are the living bread. You are the bread of life. Thank you for this ordinance, and we thank you for this holy communion of the Lord's Supper, because through this we are sanctified. Symbol of a work that you are doing yourself in our lives to sanctify us. So what is this that can block us from communing with you? Oh Lord, I pray that you may open our eyes to everyone who is listening or viewing today, that you have qualified us to commune with you. And you are calling every child of Adam to come to you, the second Adam, that we may commune together in this wonderful process of partaking of the supper. Because that's a symbol of unity and togetherness and regeneration. May our hearts be rejuvenated. May our hearts be sanctified by the water and by the blood, and by partaking, may you partake of the real life of Christ. Thank you for allowing us to study your word. And thank you for the Holy Spirit, who has been our teacher. And Lord, as we continue to read and study your word, may you illuminate our hearts and minds with the glory of heaven, that the world may be illuminated by the glory of God through us. As we close the service today, continue teaching us your way. Show us your way that is in the sanctuary, as you say. Your way, oh God, is the sanctuary. May we see you in the sanctuary. Glorify your name in us, dear Lord, in everything we do now and forever. We pray in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, the living bread of life. In Jesus I pray. Amen.